हेलो सतीश, इधर
हाँ इधर यस
वेरी नाइस। सो ईशान्य शुरू मारना।
हाँ यस
इट्स 6:35। आई फील इट्स बेटर फॉर अस टू स्टार्ट, सो एज टू रिस्पेक्ट द पीपल दैट हैव
या
ऑलरेडी। नाइस। So, welcome everybody. Good evening. Namaskara. Nan hesaru Pavan. I'm a photographer of sorts, and I'm here to conduct this session. E wildlife focus avaru bere kade iradrinda avaru network fluctuate agutte. So, I will be coordinating this session. So, yargaro question ittu anta andre chat pod alli avagle keli, illa anta andre kade tanka iddibittu neeve kelabahudu. YouTube link kuda ide, bekantandre dayavittu keli. So now, this is Satish Hetch, the guy who's showing off his images today. One of the best art-oriented photographers that I have ever come across. He's the president of Youth Photographic Society, which is a very large institution by itself. And Satish has been shooting since about 1981, before many of us were born. And his experience is greater than our age, and he has about 800 plus awards, and I'm sure he has forgotten about several of them and hasn't counted. And he was he, academically he start, studied cinematography, but he was more interested in still life photography, and he started his commercial and professionally since quite some time. He has shot almost all possible genres. He has also shot for a couple of movies, and he didn't like it and he quit. He's an avid traveler, has roamed across India quite a few times, and to Himalayas at least some 10 15 times that I know of. He conducts photo tours a few times, and yeah, I guess this is about it. Over to you, Satish. Welcome.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Pawan. That was a very short and very interesting introduction. Good evening, guys. Elrigu namaskara. Thanks for your time. You have taken your precious time in this evening and attending this webinar. And whatever possible and whatever little knowledge that I have gained in these 40 plus years in the field of wildlife photography, I'm going to share with you. In fact, from the past 1 year, this is my 20th webinar on different genres of photography. And most of them I have talked about wildlife only. I do have a lot of interest in taking pictures of landscapes, portraits, people, culture, tradition, and still life, and so many things. But basically, I'm more interested in landscapes and wildlife photography. That is my close to my heart, I could say that. So today, as Mr. Ishanya as well as Mr. Pawan had requested me to show some of my images on animals and birds. So I'll be presenting my images, and as and when you want to ask some questions, you can, or else I keep explaining about each and every aspects of photography as well as how I took those images. And I hope that this is a learning session, or you may call it knowledge sharing session, where I will be sharing my whatever I know about those species. I'll be sharing about that. And to give you a brief introduction about my photography, shall I present it, Pawan?
Yeah, please, please.
Can you just tell me, are you seeing my
Sure, I
screen?
will do, will do. Ha, can't stand it.
ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತಿದೆಯಲ್ಲ Good, Bhamta?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
So today I'm going to talk about the art of wildlife photography. See, basically what happens is there are different kinds of photography that we do. One is for just for a relaxation. Many people, they go to wildlife sanctuaries, bird sanctuaries, and just because the animals are birds, they come in front of them, they take pictures and keep it as memories, or we may call it as album pictures. But whereas my photography is concerned, I am professional in my work and I am more artistic in my work. So I look for the proper lighting and proper timing and proper emotion in animals and birds. And the artistic form of photography is very important. The composition, the lighting, the placement of subject, and thinking beyond the thing, maybe think out of the box kind, are so many other things. But basically, we must apply the thought process of composing the pictures perfectly well. That means keeping the subject properly in a frame, or waiting for the proper light, or waiting for the animals to give some actions or show some emotions, things like that. So that comes over a period of time when you get experience in going into the wild. So I have traveled more than about 52 times all over India, and I have seen all the wildlife sanctuaries and national parks across India. And I have been shooting in Nikon equipment. You can see my gadgets here, what I use, Nikon D850, and I was using D4, and all these images have been taken with these images. And I use all original Nikkor lenses from 24mm wide angle, 24 to 120mm, and I use 105mm macro for macro photography. And I use 80 to 400mm zoom lens for most of the wildlife photography, and 600mm prime lens, that is a 4 that I use for mostly for the birds. And particularly this 24 to 120mm and 80 to 400mm, I quite often use it for maybe you can say 80% of my work, maybe for landscapes as well as for animals, or taking some close-up of animals, things like that. And for photography, you have to use a tripod. So tripods are very much important. And when you are in a gypsy and wildlife sanctuaries, you cannot use a tripod on gypsy, so I carry beanbags. And just for a few of you who are youngsters and who are coming up in the field of wildlife photography, I just want to give you a few tips for the best wildlife images. Always use proper camera and lenses, because once if you go with the basic cameras and basic lenses, most of the times you get to lose very good opportunities because of lower end cameras or very short zoom lenses that you carry. So if you want to be a serious, I am telling about those who want to be serious and who are art photographers, they have to carry better cameras and lenses. But for those who are going just for relaxation or just for the love of wildlife photography, you can take any cameras and any lenses, no matter whether it is a short zoom or a wide angle or a basic camera that you have got. These are the people who go for relaxation or for the love of it. You actually enjoy wildlife more than the professional, because we concentrate mostly on our compositions, our lighting, our technical aspects of photography. So thereby we lose the attention of the beauty of enjoying the beauty of animals, the birds, or its emotions, things like that. Though we keep seeing them in viewfinder quite often, but we miss enjoying those times. But whereas the other people, they simply sit and watch, and that is what is more important in wildlife. And when you are shooting with good camera and lenses, keep a watch on your aperture, shutter speed, and what kind of ISO that you are using, because all these matters for a good wildlife image. You should also know the angle of camera, where you are sitting or standing, or you are bending down, or you are lying down on the ground to take the ground level shots, or things like that. And as you know, the lighting is very, very important for wildlife. Maybe for all genres of photography, without light, we cannot do photography, as all of you know. So the lighting, the knowledge of lighting is at most important for any photographer. The angle of light, the direction of light, the quantity of light, the quality of light, all these things are very, very important. In fact, I keep talking about the lighting itself for days together. So the lighting, the different directional light, and in those kind of lighting where animals come and stand, what kind of exposure that you give, all these technical aspects are also very important. And use of tripod, as I said, when you are not in a vehicle, tripod is a mess. And know your subject. Because behavior, knowing about the behavior of animals and birds is utmost important. 80% of your photography depends on your knowledge on the behavior of animals and birds. 10%, it depends on your equipment, what you have got, the cameras, lenses, tripod, technical know-how, all those things. Another 10%, it all depends on your luck. In spite of having the knowledge on the behavior of animals or very good equipment, if you don't have luck, very very difficult to get good images. So all these factors are very, very important to get the best of the images. And try to make storytelling images, because most of the time we have seen people taking just aim and shoot kind of images. That is good in the beginning, but as and when you become professional and as and when you grow, being an experienced wildlife photographer, I think storytelling, emotions, capturing emotions, and things like that are very important. And composition, about 75% of the environment and 25% of the animal, or 25% of the environment and 75% of the animal, these two is very important in a composition. And punctuality, being a wildlife photographer, you should be very punctual. And you have to behave yourself in the wildlife sanctuaries, because your behavior depends on not only your photography, but also the photography of others who are with you. Because if you don't behave yourself properly in the vehicle or in the sanctuary, you are not going to get good images that you actually went for. So, knowing about so many things in the behavior of ourselves is utmost important. And finally, for a wildlife photographer, being at the right time, at the right place, gives you the right picture. You have to be always at the very proper place with the proper lighting. And when you are punctual, the luck will be in your side. So try to get the best of the images in the wildlife. So now I'll be sharing my images on birds, our feathered friends. As a wildlife photographer, I started as a birder. In fact, I went for bird watching most of the time with my friend, Mr. A.K. Raju. And we went most of the times in a week. You don't believe, at least 4 or 5 days in a week, we were going for only bird watching. Being a wildlife photographer, having knowledge about the birds, different kinds of birds, its behavior, all those things is very important. And when you want to photograph birds, there are so many ways. One such this thing is bird sanctuaries, where you can sit in the boat and approach the birds in bird sanctuaries. And in bird sanctuaries, or in wildlife sanctuaries, the birds are not they're not scared of human beings because they are so much acclimatized to the boats or the movement of human beings and things like that. They come very close to you, and you can start your bird photography aiming at birds, trying your good sharpness, are trying flight of the birds, are doing compositional factors, are trying to take in backlighting. All these things you can try it out there. The next is approaching the birds in your vehicle. To approach the birds in your vehicle, you have to be a good driver, and you should know how to approach the birds slowly and steadily. Then the birds will not get scared, and they think that you are a friend, and they stay there and pose for you. And you have to approach from the far distance, and slowly, slowly you have to approach closely, and you can use short zoom to take the bird picture. You can see when you attempt slowly for the bird, how closely you can go to the bird. And particularly in photography, getting the bird at a close distance and keeping the environment intact and showing the bird in all its beautiful, glorious colors is very important. So there, the processing comes into hand. No matter how best photographer you are, if you don't know processing, it is very bad. To be a complete photographer, you should know the technicalities of photography, the nuances of environment, wildlife, everything. And apart from all this, knowing about the processing is at most important, because that is where you are going to show how you have seen the bird or the animal when you were shooting. So that means you have to bring the same colors and same tone in the picture. And approaching the bird through the height is another way of photographing birds. So sitting in the hide, the birds will not know that you are inside the hide. So they will come and sit on the perches, their favorite perches. They keep eating the berries or fruits or whatever they are. So you can sit inside the hide and take pictures. Most of the people, probably you are all used to some of the hides in Bangalore, are in North India, in Sattal, or Coorg, or so many places. But believe me, about 25 years back, when I went to a sanctuary near in Jaipur called Sariska. So Sariska Wildlife Sanctuary was one of the finest sanctuaries at that time, known for tigers. So there was a hide inside the middle of the sanctuary. It was built with mud and stone, and only about the 2-3 people they can sit inside the hide and spend even the night, day and night. You can sit day and night and watch the animals at a very close distance, because this hide was constructed just right on the water area, a small pond. And I have spent 2-3 nights alone, all alone, 2-3 days inside that hide. So that hide concept, it came about 25 years back. This is not very old, or it is not new or things like that. It was there. But later on, due to various reasons, they demolished that hide. But anyway, now coming to birds taken from the hide, as you know, this is a golden oriole male and this is a female. And when you shoot pictures of birds, keep it in mind that the background plays a very important role. Unless and until the background is very clear of any disturbances like sticks or branches or trees or so many other factors, it's not going to have any impact in the picture. So the background plays a very important role. It should be very neat and clean. How you can achieve this is by using longer focal lenses. So if you use 400mm, 500, 600 and all, these longer the focal length, it will have very shallow depth of field. So even in spite of keeping F11 or F16, you don't get to see depth in the background. So using longer focal lenses are always better for bird photography. This is a lesson that the woodpecker taken at Sattal. Of course, the getting Himalayan birds in front of your camera, in front of your lens, is very, very difficult. And if you go in the jungle, in the thick jungle, unknown place, you may not be succeeded to get pictures like this. So there also in Himalayas, we have bird hide. So through which you can take pictures. There is nothing wrong in sitting inside the hide and taking pictures, because these are all natural. Only the thing is the people, they provide the food for them. That's all. It is just like when you go to Lal Bagh, people throw some biscuits or mixture at pigeons and other things when it comes and sits on a perch you take. Very similarly here also in the hide, they provide food for them. That is to attract them. But they sit naturally on the perches or branches or things like that. And you can take well-composed and in very good lighting, you can take images. And this is a lesson back to golden woodpecker. You can see the colors that is on the bird. You exactly are seeing the same colors here. So that means irrespective of the color, the white balance or the lighting conditions during that time, you have to get the right colors on the bird. So the white balance in the camera, I usually keep it in daylight. I never ever use auto white balance. Auto white balance, the camera takes over and it gives whatever the color balance it wants at that particular lighting condition. So I don't use the auto white balance. I always keep it in daylight condition. Even if I am shooting in night shots also, I use the daylight white balance. If you try and succeed, you will know why I am using it. So it gives a perfect lighting and white balance, even that lighting condition also. And the advantage of using 600mm prime lenses are that the sharpness will be ultimate. No other zoom lenses can give so much of crispness, so much of sharpness, unlike prime lenses. Prime lenses are not zoom lenses. They are fixed focal length lenses. You will get it in so many variations of focal length, like 200mm, 300mm, 400, 500, 600, 800, like that. So using prime lenses are very, very important being a professional photographer. And when it comes to composition, I would like to show the environment that the bird lives. The surrounding beautiful flowers, the branches of small plants or things like that, it adds beauty to the picture. And always I try to show the anatomy of the bird as it was found. The natural size of the bird, it should be shown. For example, in this bird, the oriental white tine, as soon as you look at this picture, you will know this bird is very small, smaller than our house sparrow. So you should get that idea, what is the size of this bird. Supposing if I increase this and make it a full frame, it becomes bigger than our myna. So it gives a wrong impression for the onlooker. So that is the reason, being a wildlife photographer, you should always maintain the size of the bird as seen. And also you have to beautify the images by adding the flowers, the plants, or things like that. So many other things. And many of the times when the birds are in action, we have to be very, very careful and very fast in focusing. Just like this blue-tailed bee-eater is just relaxing by stretching the wings, and that time I took this picture. And sometimes when you get an opportunity of doing some artistic compositions, you must aim at that. There's a cormorant sitting on a branch with a reflection, and it's in a silhouette picture. Silhouette is nothing but the black against the white, or the dark picture against the bright background. And there won't be any details on the bird in this kind of lighting situations called as silhouette. So this was one of the silhouettes that was taken recently in Kanha National Park. And the reflections that I added in the composition, means these are all original, not added later on during the process, nothing like that. In wildlife, there is no manipulation. There is nothing that you can add or remove later in processing at all. You should depict the nature as it is. So this is the original reflection of the tree in the top that I included in the frame that gives the depth in the picture. And as I said, when the action happens, it happens for a very few seconds, or many, very few, fraction of a second. So this is a coil, female coil. It's just calling or giving a signal to other birds. And very, very rarely, it flaps its wings of the feather, so the, like a fan. So this happens for a fraction of a second. Even though my camera can take 12 frames per second, I could not able to replicate the same kind of feather design in my second or third image. So you can just imagine how fast they do it. This is a cebia, Himalayan cebia, and a beautiful peach flower. So adding, the flowers, how it is going to add beauty to the picture. It's not only in Bangalore, wherever you find the bird, you try to get it when they are all sitting on a perch like this. We must aim for that. So birds are sitting on a branch which is dry or without any shape or things like that, it's common. But you have to be something different from others. So when the opportunity comes, we have to aim for such kind of composition. And sometimes the perches that we cannot find out, or we don't have the option of selecting perches, but these birds, they have their own favorite perches, like a thick branch of a tree, or broken branches or things like that. This is a green magpie, one of the rarest in the Himalayan out of Himalaya. So we get it in our camera. Most of the times we see them flying in front of us, but it never comes in front of you. So this was taken with 600 mm, and most of the times, even if we have option of taking the birds at a very close distance, I opt for some of the beautiful patterns in the images. Like you can see here, an owlet sitting pretty near its nest. I added in the picture these beautiful branches, the curves and all those things. It gives it shows the kind of environment that these birds they live. It gives a beauty to the picture. And when action happens, there is a red-crested pochard male taken in Gajoldoba in West Bengal near Darjeeling. And these are the winter migratory birds that come to India. And when the action happens, your shutter speed should go up to 2000 or 2500 per second. So the shutter speed should be very high, and we should anticipate the moment that the bird will fly now, and the bird will fly to left or right. That you should be very careful. By looking at the mood of the bird, you get to know all these things. And the birds, like a small blue kingfisher, though they are very active and very fast flying birds, they are very much used to human beings. They are used to boats, they are used to people walking around, things like that. They're quite friendly also. So you can go quite close and take them. These small blue kingfisher, a variant that we get it in Bitarkanika Bird Sanctuary in Orissa. So here in South India, we have got a small blue kingfisher in a very navy blue color. Here the colors of the blue are quite different. And adding colors in the picture is very, very important. You can see the red whiskered bulbul, the whisks and the tail portion of the underparts of the bird is red, matching with the red fruit. So this doesn't come very often, this opportunity doesn't come very often to you, but when the opportunity comes, we have to align the whole composition and the lighting in such a way that it is very, very pleasing to the eye. There's a red-billed blue magpie taken in Uttarakhand, that's near Sattar. And this is one of the most beautiful birds, I would say, and one of my favorite birds also. And from a very, very long time, I have been behind these birds, capturing them in a full frame, which I could not have done in all these years. But only last year in March, I could able to get them in a full frame. And there is a hornbill taken in Dandeli. So always it is not necessary that you have to take birds in full thing. Sometimes you can take the birds in close up and show the beautiful head and the shape of the beak, or the beautiful red eyes, or the design part of the neck, so many things. You can show them in a very close-up this thing. And what they are doing, they are eating the fruits, or they are feeding the chicks, or they are fighting with the male or female like that. All these things, you can take it in close-up. It gives very beautiful dimensional picture. And like you can see, the beautiful jungle fall. There is a male red jungle fawn taken in Uttarakhand. The colors are so beautiful and rich. The richness of these colors that I have seen while taking the picture, the same thing you can see it right in front of you. The ball shape of body of the male, it's so beautiful. And believe me, I actually loved this type of face-to-face composition than sideways. When you take the jungle fowl in the sideways, it gives a beautiful anatomy of the bird, the beautiful feathers, all those things. But I love this because of the ball shape and the beautiful feathers, the golden feathers and the red crest of the bird. All these things, it adds beauty to the image. And here you can see the fantail flycatcher. It's a mirror image. It is looking at its own image in the water. So when it comes to drink the water, they look down. So that time I took this picture. So these are the lovely moments in the wildlife that we should we will be waiting for. And after looking down, it gets into the water for a good bath. And the birds as well as the animals, they always love to take bath. This is kind of a beautiful formation of maybe you may call it as a dance or a farewell this thing to a photographer. This particular action of this bird, I have never seen earlier with any of the other birds. So maybe it may be picking up the insects in the wings or giving a farewell to the photographer. I don't know, but I loved this action. And very seldom this action also, it happens, the sunbird, the purple rumped sunbird, male on the top and the female at the bottom. And during the mating season, or during the feeding time, things like that, the female comes and it was actually dancing like this, upside down, sitting next to the male, again coming down and looking here and there, and tickling the male like that. it happened. I have shot about 15 to 20 frames like this. So this is also one of the rare occasions in my bird photography that I have come across. And interactions in birds is very, very important. Maybe the male and the female or the rival or whatever you may call. So they keep fighting, they keep talking, they give some good actions. So these are some of the moments. You can see here also in coppersmith bird barbet, you can see very similar action. So maybe there could be some of the reasons, or maybe they are playing, or maybe during the mating season they may give a play like this. But quite often the different species of birds, they fight for the food. During the food, when they are eating, this was taken in attack of food. If another species comes, they really kick them off. This happens many times, and I have seen in many of the bird species. It could be same species or different species like that. And here, the male and female, the couple, Himalayan great barbet. And I don't have to say who is the male here. So taking this kind of interaction, it gives blue color on the male of this college pheasant pair. You can see the blue and the red are complementing each other. And the dark background is really highlighting the birds, actually. Because the background is dark, the birds are more highlighted. So this kind of artistic way of capturing the birds is very important. And here you can see the jungle bush quail, the male and female at a water source. It shows in what kind of vegetation these birds are found. The background grass, it started calling all the birds. And here in the center of the image, you can see the mother. And on the right and left, two chicks. Each of them sitting and talking to the mother. And it's quite but natural for any wildlife photographer. As soon as they take the picture, they try to look at the back of the camera, whether they have got the picture, whether it is sharp or not. That is most important. They try to blow it up and see. By the time, you may lose this picture. So always I tell my friends and everybody that once you go into the wild, you start taking pictures for the first time, the first frame or first few frames rather, you check for exposure, the proper exposure, the proper shutter speed, aperture, blah, blah, blah. Then you forget looking at the back of the camera. You miss such kind of beautiful action. And here you can see Himalayan griffon vulture. The beauty of this picture is the title should match the picture. When you say Himalayan griffon vulture, this griffons, they come to desert in Rajasthan also. I've taken the same vultures in Rajasthan deserts also. Or Sal Chappar also it comes. But taking there is entirely different. When the title of the bird is called the Himalayan griffon vulture, I love to presume that it is found in Himalayas. So I try to show the Himalayas at the back. This I had an opportunity of while I was trekking to Kalia Top in Munchiari Ranges. This is one of the second peak of the Panchachuli peaks in Uttarakhand. So there I could see these birds sitting, and I composed in such a way that in the backside, in the background, I should get Himalaya. So this was one of the very rare moments for me. And here you can see how the animals and birds and the entire animal kingdom, they live very happily, closely, without any caste and creed or religion or anything. And they are not bothered whether the crocodile will eat away the river tongue or things like that. They live happily and they know when to fly and things like that. This is a gharial basking in the sun, as well as the river tongue. basking in the sun together with the career. This was taken in Corbett National Park. And now I come to the animal section. One of my most favorite in animals is the elephant. So the Lord Ganesh is represented as an elephant in the Hindu mythology, as well as we believe that Lord Ganesh is there representing through the elephant. And this is one of the most beautiful and most perfect anatomy of the animal that I have seen. So this was taken in DR Hills while I was driving in the car. I just took a U-turn and came face to face with this animal. And this was taken at 3:30 in the afternoon. And the golden light that is falling on the elephant, you can see the most beautiful position of the legs, the trunk, the tusks, the crossed tusk, which is very, very rare among tuskers. So the crossed tusks is very important. The ear position is the flaps opened up, and the beautiful face of the animal looking at you. This is the perfect posture of a tusker. That is what I loved it. And you can see the whole forest, the kind of forest that BR Hills has got. The BR Hills is nothing but the extended forest area of Bandipur range. And here, particularly in BR Hills, the elephants are quite dangerous, but we have to behave ourselves to get such kind of images. And elephants that are found in Corbett National Park. The Corbett National Park has got the most beautiful elephants and the largest congregation of the Asiatic elephants you can find there. And each group may contain from 30 to 40 elephants to 80 elephants. And I have seen a large congregation of 80 plus elephants many of the times. And the formation you can see.
Satish, your screen is not visible.
Not visible. ತೋರಿಸ್ತಿದ್ದೀನಲ್ಲ ಎಲ್ಲಿಂದ
ನೀವ್ ಕ್ಯಾಮ್ರಾದಲ್ಲಿ ನೀವ್ ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೀರಾ ಸ್ಕ್ರೀನ್ ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತಾ ಮತ್ತೆ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀರಾ
ಹಾ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ
ಇಟ್ಸ್ ವಿಸಿಬಲ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ
ಎಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಬರ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ಈಗ ಕಾಣ್ತಿದ್ಯಾ
ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸೀ ದ ಸ್ಕ್ರೀನ್
ಹಾ ಓಕೆ ಓಕೆ ಈಗ ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತಾ
ಇದೆ ಈಗ ಕಾಣ್ತಾ ಇದೆ
ಅಲ್ಲ ಎಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಮಿಸ್ ಆಯ್ತಾ
ಎಲಿಫೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಈ ಪ್ರೀವಿಯಸ್ ಹಾ ಇದಲ್ಲ ದ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಒನ್
ಇದಾಯ್ತಲ್ಲ
ಪರ್ಫೆಕ್ಟ್ ಹಾ ಹಾ ಇದು ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತು ಇದರ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಒನ್ ಕಾಣಿಸಿಲ್ಲ
ಯಾ ಯು ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಮಿಸ್ಡ್ ಒನ್ ಪಿಕ್ಚರ್ ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಎನಿ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಫಾರ್ ದಟ್ ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ಐ ಮೀನ್ ಟು ಸೇ ಇಸ್ ವೆನ್ ದ ಎಲಿಫೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಇನ್ ಎ ಗ್ರೂಪ್ ದೇ ಡೂ ಎ ವೆರಿ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿಫುಲ್ ಫಾರ್ಮೇಷನ್ ವೆದರ್ ವೈಲ್ ರನ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಆರ್ ವೈಲ್ ಬೀಯಿಂಗ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್ ಆರ್ ವೈಲ್ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ದ ಯಂಗ್ ಒನ್ಸ್ ದೇ ಮೇಕ್ ಎ ಡಿಫ್ರೆಂಟ್ ಫಾರ್ಮೇಷನ್ ಸೊ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಬಿ ವೆರಿ attentive and very fast in capturing those moments. And during this particular time, I shot about 60 to 70 images continuously. But this particular position of elephants, I liked it because you can see all the heads of the elephants nicely. All the trunks are in different positions and they are protecting the calf in between them. That's very, very interesting. And Corbett is the place for elephants. And now is the season. Unfortunately, we cannot go. In fact, last year also I missed it. And before that, I have been to Corbett probably about 9 to 10 times. And I never go behind the tigers in sanctuaries. I take pictures of all the animals, all the birds, everything. I never go behind tiger. In fact, if I get the tiger in front of me, then only I take pictures. Otherwise, I am not fan of a tiger like that. Because most of the time when we get into sanctuaries, driver says, sir, there is a tiger, we'll go there. I take them in the opposite side and go in search of other animals. So this is the Ram Ganga River, the beautiful Ram Ganga River, and the Corbett has got the beautiful meadows. And early morning, the elephants which are in the grasslands. In the previous night, they spend in the grassland, and in the morning they come to Ramganga River, have a good bath, as well as they drink water. They play in the water for some time, and then they go cross the river and go into the forest. And again in the evening, they cross back and go into the meadow. This is quite a day-to-day life for the Pachydams there. And the composition you can see, though I had a 600 mm on my another body, but I composed this in using my 80 to 400 mm lens. So that is what is important, how much to include the beautiful river, the beautiful forest, the meadows, all these things you have to show in the picture. The lighting condition, this is the first sunlight in the morning that is falling on the elephant. And when they run back to the herd, that also, it looks very pretty, comedy kind of this thing, but even in spite of that, it looks so beautiful. And here you can see one a huge tusker in the Corbett National Park. I was just about 20 feet away from this tusker. This tusker is in must. And, you can see the must glands on next to the ear, between the eye and the ear. It is called as the must gland. The must juice is oozing because during the mating season, this happens for the male elephant, the tusker. And they are in search of the partner. So during that time, the tuskers will be very ferocious. And approaching them at a very close distance is also very dangerous, unless you know the movement of the elephant. You cannot go very close. And what I liked was the vegetation. Beautiful cloudy lighting. The cloudy lighting is always very good for the animals. Because you don't get very harsh shadows on the body. So the soft lighting, it makes pretty beautiful. The whole picture becomes very beautiful. And here you can see how close we can approach the tusker. Once if you don't disturb the animal, if you by your behavior, if you tell them that you are not going to harm and you are going to be friendly with them, not moving the vehicle front and back, taking reverse, honking and all, it is going to disturb them a lot. So being at the close distance for the animal, you can take many moods of the elephant. And here you can see the one of the cow elephant taking a dust bath, and a mother and calf. And I have seen in elephants, the symmetry they maintain very well. You can see the beautiful trunk position is just like both of them doing the same work together. And even when they are walking, I have got many pictures, symmetrical pictures. The position of the leg of the mother and the calf are same. So this symmetrical this thing, it works out very well with elephants. And sometimes minimalistic images also do pretty well. This is just to show even the gigantic elephant, the biggest of the animal, land animal, looks so small in front of the nature. The beautiful landscape of Corbett, it has minimalized the structure of the elephant. This is a mother and cub. And the tigers, when they become 18 months old or 2 years old, they almost grow to the level of the mother. So on the left hand side, you can see the mother, and the right is the cub. And even in tigers also, when you are quite comfortable with them, and when the animal feels that you are not going to harm them, or you are not a disturbance, they allow you at a very close distance. This is not by force. I have gone close. They have come very close to our feet. In fact, they walked in front of us, and they are just passing by the side of our gypsy. This is I think I have shot this with a wide angle lens, probably at 8 feet or 10 feet distance. And this was taken, this leopard called the temple leopard, taken in Kabini jungle in Magarole. And this was probably at 4 o'clock or 4:30 in the evening. And the camouflage is very important in animal kingdom, how well they camouflage themselves with the environment, particularly the leopards and the tigers during the dry season. They camouflage very well in the forest. And this is a sloth bear, and the sloth bears are more dangerous than the cats. So they can be, I mean, you can take the pictures of sloth bears in our Daroji National Park, and here you can see the piggyback of sloth bear cubs, and they come quite close in the evening time, where I have to camouflage myself in the car with the camouflage cloth and all. So the sloth bears, they come at 5:30 in the evening, but I have to be inside the car by 2 o'clock or 2:30. I'm waiting for them, and then they come down at 5 o'clock or 5:30, where you can take pictures. Otherwise, going at that time when the animals come, they will not allow. They will just get scared and get away into the boulders. This is the kind of vegetation that they are found in the boulders and rocky terrain of the Daroji National Park close to Hampi. And what I want to add was the yellow-throated martin that was found in Uttarakhand near Chopta when I went for a small trek in the grasslands of Chopta in the upper Himalayas. So I found this yellow martin among the beautiful rhododendron flowers. Rhododendrons, they bloom during the first week, last week of March. Till May last week, it will be there. And there are more than 60 varieties of rhododendrons they are found. And they are very, medicinally, they are used everywhere. And they are used for the juice also. The juice made out of this is very, very tasty. So getting this yellow-throated martin, usually many of the people, they get it on the road or by the side of the road or tree branch like that. But I was quite lucky on that day while I was looking for Monal pheasants and other things. I came across this yellow martin looking for something else in this tree. It usually hunts on small birds or bird nests. It eats away the bird eggs and small geckos, things like that they feed on. So it has come in search of that, and I got this image. So this is one of the Ramganga River, their male and female spotted deer crossing. There's a Barasingha taken in early morning mist in Karna National Park. Here is a pair of Barasingha. Actually, the male is in the shadow and the female is in the light. So there's a kind of very rare this thing, got it. And here you can see the reflection of the Barasingha in the water. So the Barasingha is just above this frame. It's feeding on the grass, and its reflection was seen in the pond. And here you can see mother with calf and the auntie by the side of it. And this is a female Barasingha taken in Karna National Park. Is a egret. Usually these Barasinghas, called as hard ground Barasinghas, they are found only in Karna and some parts of Manas sanctuaries. Manas sanctuaries in North India. And here in Karna, they feed on underwater plants. So here it was feeding inside the plant, and when they lift the head, we could get this kind of water droplet. A pair of egrets flying in Tharoba National Park. A very early morning shot where you can see the mist is just coming out of the water. There's a sambar male. It's trying to feed on the young leaves of the tree. A pair of peacocks. A spotted deer in the very golden lighting during the rainy time. This is a spotted deer in the early morning mist. This is a close-up of the antlers of spotted deer. And only the deers have antlers which they shed during a season. And the antelope, they don't shed their antlers. Here you can see the beautiful curvy shape of the bison. It's not bison. Actually, it is wrongly called as bison in India. There are no bison in India. It's an Indian gaur. So as soon as many people, they see this, they call it as bison. Just like hoopoe is called as a woodpecker. So it is wrongly called as this thing. So here we can see the Indian gaur and all the flies around its body. When they just turn here and there, you can see the flies flying. A beautiful leopardess, very bold and beautiful leopardess of Tharoba National Park. And it comes quite close many of the times. And most of the times, I was more than enjoying this situation. I was trying to change my lenses quite often because it was going far. It was playing again. It was coming next to me and standing next to us. Things like that. Again, I have to change the body and the lens. Though I had two bodies, I should keep changing it now and then. So it was giving a big difficult time because it was so easily it was coming close to the vehicle. Here you can see the pair of wild dogs. Wild dogs are one of the most ferocious ಇದು ಟೈಮ್ ಇಸ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಇದೆ ಅಲ್ಲ ಪವನ್ ಫೈವ್ ಟೆನ್ ಮಿನಿಟ್ಸ್ ಸೊ ಓಕೆ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸೊ ವೈಲ್ಡ್ ಡಾಗ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಫೆರೋಶಿಯಸ್ ಅನಿಮಲ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಟೈಗರ್ ಆರ್ ಲೆಪರ್ಡ್ ಆರ್ ಎನಿಥಿಂಗ್ ಬಟ್ ದ ವೈಲ್ಡ್ ಡಾಗ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಫೆರೋಶಿಯಸ್ ದ ಹಂಟ್ ಇನ್ ಪ್ಯಾಕ್ಸ್ ಪ್ಯಾಕ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ 13 to 17 ಡಾಗ್ಸ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್ It's a pack of large number of dogs. They always move. But here in Tharoba, there was a pack of five. And when the tigress had cubs, these dogs were consistently, they were disturbing them. So the tigress has killed three of the wild dogs. But during this time when the tiger has cubs, these wild dogs always aim for the cubs and they can kill even the gaur also. So they are so ferocious. When they are in the big pack, even the tigers are afraid of them. This is a female dog urinating. And I observed this kind of action only now. Though I have taken a lot of wild dog pictures in different sanctuaries. But here, for the first time, I saw it lifting two hind legs and urinating. And this is not first time. It did many times. It's quite rare. I don't know. If somebody knows, they have to tell me the reason. And here you can see the ibis. It was about to land on the ground because the dog was there. It took a turn and went away. And the dog is observing that. And the playful dogs, when they are sitting without any this thing, any hunt or on the hunt, they sit and play together. Pair of wild dogs. And all this I shot with 600mm because my camera was fitted with 600mm. I did not want it to change the body, the lens, things like that. I wanted to capture only the close-up, but I could get the whole body. So I did not bother. So I could get a very good framing of both the animals. Now I come to the last part of my talk, the story of the stripes. So the tigers, as all of you know, they have these stripes very unique to each animal. And just like human fingerprints, they are unique to every single animal. No single animal can replicate the stripes of the other tiger. The markings are entirely different. Here in this picture, the tourists, they are looking at the tiger. There is a very young adult, a beautiful young adult in Tadoba, in the first early morning light around 7:30 or so in the morning. These tourists, they came across this, and I was on the other side of the vehicle. The most important thing for a Hindu is that you can just see all the animals, tigers, the langurs, monkeys, or elephants, so many things, even the crocodiles or the owl, they're all connected with the Hindu mythology. The gods and the goddesses, they all have the vehicle called as the tiger, the elephant, the crocodile, things like that. So we always see that being a Hindu, we always keep a very different kind of respect for these animals, being a Hindu. So the tourists, as soon as they saw this on their own, they were doing namaskara to this tiger. And I got a continuous frame. And of course, I did not observe while taking the picture. But while segregating the images, I was also seeing the behavior of people after uploading onto the computer. Everybody are doing namaskara to this tiger. So that comes as a human tendency, particularly for Hindus, it comes on its own as soon as they see this tiger, the vehicle of goddess Durga. They do this namaskara, things like that. And the male tiger, there was a beautiful, huge male that was roaming about near the buffer zone of Tadoba. This was a new male that had entered at the Tadoba range. And here it has sniffed the scent of the female or the other male and doing this gesture called as Fennel's gesture. So this was very close, about 15 feet away from me. The same tiger, it just crossed the road and came to the small puddle where it had a very little water. So it drank little water and sat there for some time, posing for me. So this was very close distance of about 15 feet with my 24 to 120 mm zoom lens. I shot these images, and here you can see it is watching a sambar or a spotted deer in, and it has lifted its head. The ears also, and most of the times these white spots on the back of the ear, that also gives the signal for the cubs also. If this male was in the group of a female or the cubs or things like that, the cubs or the female would have taken the signal from this white markings on the ear, and they follow it. Because in the grasslands, only the ears can be seen. And usually we find the tigers with the help of the pug mark. So you can see the foot of the tigress here, the shape of this, the footprint of this when it is there on the ground, it forms a beautiful pug mark. So we follow this, and this pug mark is so many stories, so many information that gives the age of the tiger, whether it is a male or a female, the age of the animal, and whether it is a cub or an adult, or how much time before it has just passed this area, and whether it is fresh or old one, and so many informations we'll get by looking at the pug mask. And here you can see one of the most successful and beautiful tigress of Tadoba presently, the Maya. This tigress Maya has given birth to 4 cubs, and now it is in Kanha. There are approximately about 10 tigress have given birth, and approximately about 42 cubs are there, and a lot of tiger movement in Tadoba. And here the tigress is relaxing. Here you can see with one of the cubs, it had made a kill, sambar kill, on the previous night, and it is just close to the sambar kill. In this picture, you can see the sambar kill which it had made in the previous night on the waterfront in a small pond. And you can see beautiful, nicely grown up cubs. There are 4 actually. One has it's drinking water on the right hand side. So other 3 cubs are in the frame. And usually the skin of the sambar, as soon as it kills, it opens from the rear end because it is the softest portion, and opens it up for the cubs to eat it. Otherwise, the cubs cannot rip off from the sambar skin. So the mother helps them to open up the skin, and they can eat the flesh easily. And they always try to protect the kill from other scavengers. Bird scavengers or animals or whatever. So they always protect it. So they stay close to the kill. So getting tiger and the cubs and things like that, it's quite rare, because in my visit to sanctuaries for so many years, this is the first time I got tigress with cubs. So one must be lucky. Maybe after 40 years of experience, I became lucky probably. So I got this for the first time. And you can see here the tiger cub is actually shooing away the pandaran. The observation here is that probably even the elephant and the tiger, they don't like any other small birds coming in front of them. They don't like intruders. So they try to shoo away the birds. I have seen in many of the occasions. So this is probably the last picture of the white-breasted kingfisher. And at the back, you can see the tiger cub relaxing and watching the white-breasted kingfisher. So thank you so much, all of you, for your patient listening, and I hope it was useful for you. And in case if you have any questions or anything, you can ask me.
Satish, there is one question that I see in the chat pod. When do you prefer, or when can we prefer black and white?
See, the whole pictures, the whole show, what you have seen, I have got in black and white. So it is not, it's not a rule, that because most of the photographers, they say that whenever the colors are dull or whenever there are no colors, they can turn into black and white. It is not like that. Whenever you get a good contrast, whenever there is a black and white material in the picture, you can turn into black and white photos. So it's a personal choice. So some of the pictures which you may like in black and white, I may prefer in color. to black and white.
Okay, thank you. So, Ashtay, question Niradu. So, if anybody has any other questions, feel free to unmute and ask. Another Kilbe Consultant.
Either everybody got a good information or nobody understood.
Well, everybody is stunned. Oh yeah, there are a couple of them left. What is the best lens for long distance photography?
Long distance photography is 600 mm, preferably.
Long distance landscape, they asked.
Landscape, okay. See, I have taken many of the landscapes in my 300 mm and 400 mm. I prefer to shoot landscape in longer focal length distance than wide angle. I don't like the wide angle landscape because in a focal length of 300 or 400 mm, you can really compose perfectly well. And some of the things which you don't see it in the compositions which you don't see it in wide angle, you get beautiful composition in longer focal length. So up to 400 mm, I have used for landscape.
Excellent. How to get separation in post-processing, sir?
See, actually, in post-processing, by giving a good contrast, you can get separation, and also using different tools in Photoshop or in Lightroom, you can get a separation in the background and the subject. But the first and foremost thing is you have to expose perfectly well when you take pictures. So some of the mistakes what you have done while taking images can be rectified or rather improved during processing for a very minimal thing, maybe a 10% or 20%. But if you have shot perfectly well, you can really recreate it while processing.
Excellent. Also, I don't know if we should be going into the post-processing portion. Yeah, any which way. I have 600D with kit lens. Is it possible to take wildlife and birds?
As I said, if you are a keen wildlife photographer, if you go to forest to enjoy, you can take this lens and take pictures with whatever the kit lens that you have. But to become a professional wildlife photographer, you need to have longer focal length lenses and a good camera, much better model than what you have got. But for a beginner, this pretty good camera which you can take good images. And don't think that you always can make beautiful wildlife images only if you have longer focal length lenses or anything. With kit lens, depending on the opportunity that you get, you can make a lot of beautiful images.
Okay, what is the best software for post-processing?
Though Lightroom is meant only for photographers for post-processing, I am more experienced and love to work with Photoshop than Lightroom. So both has got its own advantages. And because of my easiness with Photoshop, I use Photoshop more than Lightroom. It all individual. How you start working with your pictures, with what tool, that depends on you. So I have started with Photoshop and I am continuing with Photoshop. I'm pretty easy with that.
Excellent. So, which I asked, I'm a beginner starting with Nikon 5600 with 7300 mm lens. I'm facing difficulty in focusing with manual mode, sir. Please suggest some tips for improvement, Anta.
First of all, for any beginner, manual is very important. Giving exposures manually, focusing manually, all these things, it will improve your photography to a greater level. So first and foremost thing is do continuously manual focusing. You will get a very precise focusing on your subject. And why you are not getting sharpness in manual mode is probably you might not be focusing properly exactly where you want it. Or sometimes it also happens that the lens is not aligned with the body. You have to do alignment. So this alignment, it comes in some professional bodies where when you go to the menu, you can change the menu and do the lens and the body alignment. But in certain amateur cameras like 5600 and other things, that particular this thing they have not provided. You try to change a different lens of your friends or something and try to see if there is any fault in the lens. And if there is any fault, you can get it rectified. Otherwise, manually, you have to get a perfect sharpness. There's no doubt about it.
Okay. So, Prashant, I don't know if this there's a question with that. Hi, sir. If we want to capture animals, we want to visit parks, but it's difficult to offer safari many times for students. They charge around 300 per safari. This I don't know if this can be answered by Satish. So we'll skip to the next one. Any tips for a beginner for balancing work life along with wildlife photography as a passion?
Yes, it's an individual time management. You know, we cannot actually tell you that you have to spend 1 week time in wildlife. So it's quite impossible for the people who are working. So you have to take out your brief time that you have got, maybe weekends or maybe holidays, things like that. You have to combine with your leave and then go for everything. But unless and until you stay for 2-3 days minimum in a wildlife sanctuary, you may not be successful in capturing a very good wildlife, because it all depends on the luck. And luck in not only in getting the animals, but also getting good light and the good animal at the right time. So we usually stay for almost about 10 to 12 days in each sanctuary. But for a beginner, for people who are working, it may not be possible. So minimum of 3 days of stay in a sanctuary is very important. So your time management depends on you.
So, sir, in bird photography, camera plays an important role or lenses?
For any kind of photography, a lens plays an important role, because lens is the one which is going to capture the image. The quality of your image depends on your lens. So whatever the basic body that you have got or anything, if you want to change or thinking of changing or things like that, you don't give a second thought. But you give the first thought about changing the lenses or upgrading the lenses, because the lenses makes your photography better and better, not the body. Body is one instrument to get the best exposure. And of course, I truly believe that both body and lens makes a very good combination in getting the best images. No doubt about it. But for a beginner, the first and foremost this thing is to give importance for the lens than the body. It's my honest opinion.
Okay. Anup asks, how many years are you into this passion, and which was your first camera? Anup, he's been into this for about 40 years. Satish, which was your first camera?
I started with Pentax MX manual camera, which my father gifted to me. So after that, I changed it to Nikon, and I'm still using Nikon. And of course, I have changed many models. Right from the beginning of the Nikon manual cameras to the present Nikon D850, I have changed many lenses and many bodies. And actually, all the international distinctions or the awards, all that I have got, I have finished within 100 to 300 mm zoom lens. So I finished all these awards and distinctions and all, you know, within 100 to 300 mm lens. And after so many years being into wildlife, from the past maybe 5 years or so, I bought this 600 mm. At the fag end of my wildlife journey, I'm buying this 600 mm. That is just for the love of it. Otherwise, it was not necessary. So what I mean to say is within 300 mm or 400 mm, we can do wonderful, you can take wonderful images of birds and animals and all. Don't aim for 500 or 600 mm. It is not really required.
So how do you take this from a hobby to a profession?
See, in India, wildlife as a profession is totally thing. So you can't earn even 10 rupees out of wildlife. And there are only one or two people in the whole of India where they earn out of wildlife. So I do other kind of photography jobs to earn money. But I put the same money into my passion, that is wildlife and landscape photography. So whatever I have earned there, so I spend it here for my hobby. So in India, it is quite difficult to make it as a profession. And earlier, I used to sell a lot of my images when it was in a film analog era. My main job was selling my images. I used to earn a lot of money during that time. Over the period of time during this this digital era came into this thing. So since then, I have not sold many images. It is very difficult because people, they just download it free of cost and they use it. Earlier, it was not like that. They have to depend. They were depending on me to get images. And during analog time, I had nearly about over 1 lakh images in my stock on all subjects. You ask for any subject, I had. So people from advertising agency or newspaper or media or private sector companies for their calendars or things like that, they used to approach me first to see if I have that particular picture with me. Then they were looking for others. So that was the condition during that time. Now everybody has got images, and on the internet you will get the very high quality images free of cost. So now it has totally, drastically come down. So don't think of a profession, wildlife photography as profession, it is quite difficult in India. But in foreign countries, it is very good.
Excellent. I am a school student doing bird photography. What tips will you give to process images in Lightroom Mobile?
In mobile?
Lightroom Mobile, correct.
I cannot answer this because unless I want to talk on mobile, I use mobile. Otherwise, I never use. Even to take pictures, I never use mobile. So I'm very sorry about this. I can't give you an answer. I think, Pawan, you only can answer this.
For Lightroom Mobile, the best option is to start with auto. Most of the times, auto is enough, and slight tweaking should be good enough. Otherwise, try to switch over to local corrections. For these selective editings are the most interesting and important things to make a picture better, to dodge an area, burn an area, or whichever increase texture, clarity, whatever you choose. So doing it selectively is a very important thing, and try more to go to it selectively, and don't follow the trend. No increasing clarity or texture all of a sudden to 100. Also, in Lightroom Mobile, there is something called Discover, which you can use to look at tutorials from other people. Bere avaru edit madiradana share madirtare. You can also copy those settings and paste it on your own images, and you have free examples to learn from. Idella free yar bekara kalibodu, give it a shot. Discover.
Actually, for your information, we have Youth Photographic Society, where I am the president there. So we have nearly about 800 members. On every Friday, Saturday and Sunday, we have webinars on various genres of photography, and a lot of people, they talk on different genres of photography. We also have workshops. And recently, we had one of the webinar on this particular mobile photography using Lightroom and using processing your pictures in mobile and all. So those of you who are interested, they can join Youth Photographic Society, and you can log on to www.ypsbengaluru.com. So you will get more information there, and you can become a member there.
Excellent. One from Rajaram. The program has been very interesting with beautiful images and apt explanations. How do you find difference in style of wildlife photography by Indians and abroad experts?
Well, actually, there is a lot of difference between Indian photographers and foreign photographers, particularly in their approach and their lighting and in their processing images, things like that. And the kind of lighting and the vegetation that they have got is entirely different. And the kind of vegetation that we have in India, it's a tropical country where it's thick jungles we have and the grasslands, things like that. So it's quite difficult to find animals also here. Yeah. So in foreign countries and all, it's all open jungle. It's a big, huge meadows and mountain areas. So the quality of light there is very, very good compared to our Indian conditions. In Indian conditions, wherever you go, even the purest of the place, the light quality will be very dull and not very pure light. So in foreign countries, the advantage of that is very, very important. And their approach to photography is also quite different. And in fact, I am learning by looking at others' images and trying to incorporate such kind of compositions or lighting in my photography also. I'm trying to improve upon my processing also. So all this is a learning process. We can, of course, the foreigners, even in the analog areas, the analog age also, when we were using color transparencies and all, their quality of transparency was very, very good. It was beyond imagination. Though the film was same, the processing chemicals was same, the quality of images of foreign countries are too good compared to India. And now even the digital cameras that they get and what we get, they're all same. And the processing software, the Photoshop is the same. But the approach towards the final image is entirely different and quite impressive. The foreigners, what they're doing is quite impressive. And we are way beyond them. We are quite beyond them.
Okay. There is a question from an interesting person. How to get that third eye where one can compose in a creative way? Idu Arjun Harich kelirudu. You can probably ignore this question.
No, why to ignore? Question is a question.
Okay.
See, everybody has got two eyes. So the inner eye, what we call the thought process, what we get, and how to look and react to that subject is within us. So there can be some 15 people shooting the same subject together, but because of your inner knowledge and in your thought process is entirely different compared to other 14 photographers, your picture will come out very well. That is because you have opened the third eye. That means the inner thought you have applied to your subject, which the others have not done it. So usually the human tendency is to take pictures as it is in whatever the lighting condition, aim and shoot. So over a period of time, when you become a professional in your field, you have to use this third eye, which is very important for an art photographer. For a common photographer, it's okay whether they get a blurry image or just a shake image or whatever. They are happy, okay, I got one record picture. But for us, record is not good. We want to get the best of the image of the situation. So we have to always keep open the third eye. So that creativity eye, that third eye is called as the creative eye, that you have to keep opening always and try to get the best of the images. That's quite difficult, but you have to get used to that.
Excellent. I have 550D with basic 1855 kit lens. What is the best lens I can upgrade for doing landscape and bird photography?
See, actually, by looking at others who have got very fancy and luxurious and equipment, you don't try to copy them. Actually, you have to slowly, step by step, you have to upgrade your system. So for your this thing, 70 to 300 mm is quite good, with which you can do a lot of landscapes and as well as birds and animals pictures also you can do. But you may not get the, you cannot compare with the other photographers. Don't always compare. You try to achieve the best within what equipment you have got. You can really make award-winning images within this short focal distance lenses and short zooms, like your 1835 or 70-300 mm. You can do wonderful images, but you have to be at a good place with a creative eye open.
Okay, last couple of questions. Have you ever visited Masai Mara?
No.
No. Okay. Which is your best and worst moment in wildlife?
There is no worst moment. Always, every moment was the best in my wildlife journey, and I have enjoyed each and every second of it, and I have loved each and every wildlife sanctuary and national park that I have visited, and in fact, I feel that I am really lucky among most of my relatives or friends or things like that, where I have visited most of the sanctuaries and I could be able to see some of the very rugged landscapes or beautiful landscapes or excellent animals and birds, things like that, because I have traveled a lot. So that is the only achievement that I have done in my life is traveling. I have traveled a lot and I've seen so many places. I should be lucky enough, and I thank God for that.
Okay. Do you have a wish list of shots you still want to get, bird?
Being a human, wish cannot be ended anywhere. So I got the list is so huge and so lengthy, and probably whatever the animal species and bird species that we have in India, so many species of birds and so many places to be visited. I don't think even if we take a rebirth about 7 to 10 times again and again, I don't think we can complete it. So within this time of what we are living now, whatever possible we have, we can shoot and we have shot already. That is quite a challenging one, and I think we have achieved it a little bit. Though we cannot aim for so many in this thing, but I wish to visit so many places, but I don't know how it happens.
Excellent, excellent. So, what is your favorite species, sir?
As I said, elephants are one of my very favorite animals, and I love to be with the herd for a very long time. Given the chance, even the full days and days I can spend with them, looking at their behaviors and their playfulness and their loving each and other animals together, they're playing together. All those things, watching them is just thrill. It's so beautiful. That is one of my favorite.
Rajshekar, his nickname is Tusker, so anyway, Sahana Honkan asks, Satish sir, can you share your education qualification as it can guide me?
Come again.
Education, can you share your education qualification as it can guide me?
Okay, yeah, I did a diploma in cinematography in SJ Polytechnic, and though I wanted to go into film field as a cameraman, somehow for various reasons I just stopped going there, and I started my own business, and I loved a still life photography, that is it's a still cameras that I can take pictures. And rather than movie, I wanted to show the story through my still life images. So that's what it made me challenging, take this challenging field. So since then, since 40 plus years, I have been in this field.
Excellent. So I don't see any more questions on screen or either here or... Okay, there is one more on YouTube. What do you feel about manipulation as a part of post-processing in a wildlife image by a friend, Avinash?
Probably he joined late, I think. In the beginning only I told that manipulation is not allowed in nature photography. We have to depict the nature as it is and whatever we have seen live. And some of the things like small grass coming in front of the animal or a bird, we can remove that. But you cannot duplicate the same animal and put it next to that and call it as male and female, or make it small and call it as mother and calf. Nothing like that is allowed in nature. So nature photography or wildlife photography, you may call, is depiction of the nature in its state of this thing. So it has to be natural and without any manipulation in the post-processing. And some of the, not some, most of the times we don't even, in particularly in exhibitions or salons, we don't even allow such photographs where there is a man-made thing is visible in the picture. For example, a fence or a light pole or stones that is chiseled by a human, or some houses or things like that, it is not to be seen in the picture. So wildlife images have to be truly wild and in its natural habitat.
Satish, let me, given that I know him, his question might have been on different terms. For instance, about let's say color open, some sections like that. What do you, what is your thought? Images which are manipulated. What are your thoughts?
That is what I am telling. Okay. See, in nature, manipulation is not allowed. Okay, we don't like to see unnatural things in wildlife. But of course, I have done a lot of manipulated images for the other thing. But that is a different genre of photography, manipulation. So, but when you are, when you want to show it, depict it as a nature, or depict it as a wildlife image, it has to be truly natural in all its content, 100% in its content. There should not be any manipulation. But as an art, manipulation itself is an art. The composites of putting so many things into one image and making one one image, striking image, that it comes under composites of manipulation. That is a different kind of art itself. But in nature or wildlife photography is differently, I mean, definitely it's not allowed.
Okay. What is the best place for wildlife photography? Umad Mishra asks.
Every place is beautiful. In fact, whatever the sanctuaries or the wildlife sanctuaries and national parks that you have got in India, each and every place is so beautiful. You can take right from the smallest of the sanctuary like Muthodi or BR Hills or whatever to the biggest national parks like Ranthambore or Karvet or Kaziranga. Everything has got its prime animal base or birds of its own. Or some of the sanctuaries or national parks, it's known for endemic species, which is not found in other sanctuaries. So like that, each and every place is so beautiful. Everything is important and everything is unique in its own way. So as a human being, as a wildlife lover, we have to visit all the sanctuaries to see it, to believe it. So you have to go there and visit it. It's a fantastic. India has got. That is why I'm telling, even though I am into this field about 40 years, I have not gone to Africa. Because in India itself, we have got so many sanctuaries and national parks which we cannot cover in the entire life.
Excellent. So, who are some of your favorite wildlife photographers?
There are a lot. There are a lot of photographers, both in India and abroad. And many of them I have been following, and I love their work. And yeah, there is no particular this person, that person, like that. But I like most of the top wildlife photographers' work.
One last question we'll take. On a broader perspective, do hide photographs belong to manipulation as well?
Yeah, to certain extent. As I said to you, no, in wildlife, something, a very minimal kind of a thing where there is a disturbance, like grass coming in the middle of the bird or animal or thing. Or if the bird is sitting on a perch where there is some disturbance, which you can remove it.
No. So, this is from a point where, because hides are man-made, with feed or something, let's say there is feed. If a hide is man, it is man-made, and
I know.
As it is not natural, Allah.
Yeah.
So does it still, I mean, is it okay in nature section?
Yeah, it is. It is okay in nature section. See, in the initial, this thing only, when I started talking, I spoke about hide photography.
Right.
So in hide photography, there is nothing wrong. Please don't give a negative notion about this hide photography. See, hide photography is one such area where you don't get birds at a close distance if you go on your own. Actually, I have got another set of bird photography, art of bird photography, where I speak about various aspects of birds, where you take and what is the problem and how to rectify it and all. That's a different program. In that, one of the things I take up is the hide photography. In hide photography, the people, they put fruits or feed to attract the birds. That's all. They are not going to harm the birds, or they are not going to do anything for the bird. It's not like a zoo. The birds have got freedom to fly. They can come on their own time. If they can come, they will come. If they don't come, they don't come at all. It's like that. We don't have any control. It's totally natural. And as a photographer, it is your this thing is to include that fruit or not. So depending on your lens capacity or focal length or the distance that you are sitting, you can exclude that fruit and take the picture. What is wrong? Why you want to include that fruit or a twig or whatever you want? Don't include that. You take only the bird. So the bird sitting naturally on a perch. What is wrong in that? I don't see anything wrong, because it is not that I am encouraging the hide photography, but I believe that through hide photography we could make a lot of beautiful images which we could not have done in naturally in the forest. So that difference also has shown in my earlier pictures, how difficult it is to photograph in going in the trekking in the jungle and photographing birds, and how it is easy and beautifully you can capture in the hide. There is nothing wrong in the hide. If you do mistake by including the fruit or the thread, the tie it or the wire, it comes in the picture, it is your mistake. It is nothing wrong. But the people, they provide you the platform to take the picture naturally. If you don't take naturally, it is your mistake.
Right. And the question was, does it belong to manipulation?
It doesn't belong to manipulation. Why? You are removing the disturbance in the picture. Yeah. See, manipulation is one thing that most of the people, they have misunderstood. processing the image in the Photoshop is not a manipulation. It is a processing. You have taken the raw image. It is just like raw vegetables you have brought from the market. It is for you to prepare a curry or a sambar or anything out of the raw vegetable. How you prepare is your processing, how you make it. But manipulation is nothing but when the bird is sitting, you copy the bird and put it next to the bird and tell that it is two birds, the male and female. That is manipulation. Or a bird is sitting at the back, you give a sunset image and show it was taken in sunset. That is wrong. You put a group of birds sitting at the base and show some airplanes flying on the top. That is manipulation. All these things, including pictures from outside, the other pictures and putting in one picture and making a total collage is not allowed in nature. That is manipulation.
Right.
Removing something which is disturbing in the picture is not manipulation. That is allowed.
Excellent. Let me see if I can take one more. Okay. One last one we'll take. What about nesting photography? Satish, I want you to tell this story to other people where you and Raju were shooting kingfishers and the nest was destroyed some 30 years whatever ago. I want you to tell that story to everybody. So that might answer this question.
What is this question about the nest of photography?
Nesting photography. Huh?
Yeah. See, actually, during my initial stage of bird photography, we started as bird photographers. During that time, we were going in search of birds where they have nested. Okay. So during that time, taking nest photography was not at all a problem. We could even take a mother with the chicks and show them how the chicks are fed or how the chicks look like and different kinds of birds, the chicks, how different it is and what kind of vegetation they are found, all these things. We were shooting the mother with the chicks artistically. But during this time when the salon or the competition happened, many people started getting awards and all. So this kind of competition, it entered into nature also, because once if one photographer has done the nest, the other person should, the photographer was thinking that if others find this nest, they may get the picture and win the award and all. And in this course of time, they used to, after taking the pictures, some people, they started destroying the nest, things like that. This is one of the reasons. Other reason is that in the jungle, nearby jungle in and around Bangalore, the shepherd boys, usually they follow the photographers because we were going in search of the bird nest. So as soon as we leave the place, this shepherd boys used to go and steal the eggs or the chicks and take it away. So they are also culprits. And next day when we go for photography, we never found it. See, usually the birds, they build a nest in the bush where no other predator can see. So these photographers, some of the unorganized photographers, they never gave importance to this. They used to open the nest fully, open the chicks to the this thing so that they can get the clear picture. So they never used to close the nest also. So this was attracting a lot of scavenger birds or the snakes or people like that. So we used to lose a lot of nests that time. So myself and AK Raju, we started the signature campaign. And we went to all the photographers, all over the same places and took signatures to stop this. Because people, once they enter the salon and getting awards, they were also partly they were responsible for this. So let us stop this entirely in any competition. So that move we took and we went to all the photographers and a lot of different salons and stopped with this. Now, throughout the world, they have stopped accepting images of birds at nest. So you can take a bird very close to the nest. Before approaching the nest, the bird will sit at one particular branch. So there you can take the bird, but not on the nest. So once if you do this, even if it is natural also, people may redo the same kind of mistakes later on. So totally it is stopped throughout the world. Now, in all competitions, they don't accept birds at nest. There's a story behind this.
Excellent. So, yes, that is all about it, Satish. There are quite a lot of comments thanking you for the session and great photos. Appreciate
it. Most welcome. Yeah.
Once again, thanks for taking your time off on a weekend just before and sharing your experiences and images with us on behalf of Wildlife Focus team.
Thank you so much.
To the audience, it's been around 2 hours. Thank you for patiently listening to the session and asking your questions and encouraging comments. So, Satish Anaravidya, parting words last?
No, nothing. Thank you so much for the thing and all the people that have taken their precious time in watching this slideshow. And whatever the little knowledge that I had, I shared with you. And I'm still a learner and still learning. So, over a period of time, we can share some more images.
Okay. So
thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks everybody. Thanks for joining. Team Ishanya.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ishanya, for this wonderful slideshow. The opportunity given to me. Thank you, Pawan, for that. Nice host, being a nice host.
Thank you.
Yeah, bye.
See you. Bye.